Yeah, dear students, welcome to the visual analytics lecture, the second part of dimension reduction. We discussed linear techniques in the last video lecture, in particular principal component analysis, factor analysis, as well as projection poursuite. These are three quite popular linear dimension reduction techniques. I want to start again with showing this simple workflow of using high-dimensional data and incorporating dimension reduction as an essential step before visualization and analysis. And today we want to continue with nonlinear techniques and also think about how to assess the quality of these projections. There is an information loss involved, definitely. Distortion is involved, and for the user it's interesting how strong these effects actually are. Yeah, so that is what we discussed last week. Also, this difference between dimension reduction and feature selection, where really some features or dimensions in the data are removed instead of being projected to a low dimensional space. There are two frequently used nonlinear projection techniques that should be discussed here, namely multidimensional scaling and stochastic neighborhood embedding, and in particular the later introduced variant of T-stochastic neighborhood embedding, which is based on a student T-distribution, is quite frequently used. We will also discuss the assessment of projections locally and globally, and finally think about guided dimension reduction. So dimension reduction as a process, a workflow, where visual aids are used in order to come up with good decisions with respect to the algorithm that should be used, but also with respect to the parameters that specify more in detail how this algorithm works. Let me briefly say why nonlinear techniques have been developed at all. I mentioned several assumptions that are used for linear projection techniques. So for example, if there are indeed linear relations between the different dimensions in the data, and if the distributions of the data are normally distributed, these are assumptions underlying techniques such as principal component analysis. Yeah, and of course these assumptions are not always fulfilled, and that would be one argument to use nonlinear techniques. Nonlinear techniques are also motivated by the fact that it's often more important to preserve small distances instead of higher distances as well. In general, one may say that nonlinear techniques have more degrees of freedom in order to come up with a good projection, in the sense that properties of the high dimensional data are preserved quite well in the projection. Here we see a famous data set that's used quite often as a kind of benchmark, the Swiss roll data set. I think the image explains it well enough. It's not important that it is really preserved very well, that this point here is quite far away from this one. Yeah, but if something is small in the high dimensional space, then it should be also close to each other in the low dimensional space in the projection. Yeah, so that is a major motivation. Multidimensional scaling and T-stochastic neighborhood embedding as the two major techniques that we will look at, also discuss some variants and also discuss some performance issues, because if applied really to high dimensional data with many data sets, performance really is an issue here. So we have to discuss this as well. That has two flavors. One is, of course, to efficiently implement the algorithms to avoid any unnecessary delay in the computation. But even when this is done to a strong extent, it still may be too slow for supporting an explorative process, which is to a large extent a trial and error process. So therefore, there are also variants that are progressive computations that first project a subset of the data, a carefully chosen subset, and then the user may decide whether or not it's worth to wait for the full projection or not. Yeah, let's begin with multidimensional scaling, a nonlinear iterative process, an optimization process, where the distance of points in the high-dimensional space Rn should be preserved optimally when transforming it to a lower-dimensional space Rk. Multidimensional scaling was introduced by Torgerson in 1952, and a stress function is considered as the function that is solved here, and at the end we do not only get a result in terms of an optimal projection, we also can assess this stress value that tells us on a global level how good this projection actually is. Nonlinear optimization methods are used here in this process, and gradient descent and simulated annealing are two of the most frequently used optimization techniques in this context. Gradient descent is simpler, but it is more sensitive to local minima. Yeah, optimization may stuck in a local optimum or local minimum in this particular example. That may happen here as well. So that is the computation that is actually carried out in order to assess the quality of the current projection. This is the distance of the point that we have in high-dimensional space. Yeah, we compute the differences between xi, yi to xj, yj, and then we have here a remaining error term that relates to the stress value. And in this optimization process, this error term should be smaller and smaller. So it's a similarity-based projection in low-dimensional space, and the core here of this method is a distance metric. Yeah, so what is actually the distance between a pair of points? A simple decision, also frequently used decision, is the Euclidean distance. Yeah, that can be applied in any dimension, of course. So that is one viable choice. In some situations, the city block distance may be a better choice. So with the city block distance, you can only go in orthogonal directions. Yeah, so you compute a distance in every dimension and add them. Another situation that would be useful, for example, in text analytics, is the angle between two feature vectors. Yeah, we briefly talked about text analytics with respect to bike clustering, for example. Yeah, we may have large sets of documents, and we know which words occur in these documents. We also have some metadata, like the creation date. So that all forms our feature vector, and we can compute the angle between them based on the arcus cosinus. So that's basically the scalar product, which is a little reformulated here. The product of the two feature vectors is divided by the product of the magnitude of these two vectors, and the magnitude of the vectors is larger than the vector is. So this term is always between 0 and 1. It's definitely positive, but it cannot exceed 1. And yeah, the angle between these vectors is computed with the arcus cosinus function. Yeah, and just to be complete here, the product of the two vectors is computed component-wise and then summed up, as you see here. Yeah, so the user may select one of these matrices. He may even fix certain points as constraints that should be preserved very well. And yeah, we have seen that we often have in scatter plots, for example, multi-class data, for example, because we applied a clustering algorithm first, and we know that elements belong either to cluster A, B, or C. Yeah, and we may also use the cluster label as part of the distance metric. Yeah, so these are only some typical choices. It could be a combination of different things. That could be in particularly necessary if we have heterogeneous data, as we have discussed several times, where we have some dimensions that are categorical or even binary, whereas others are scalar values. Yeah, that typically leads to a more complex distance metric as compared to the three simple examples I've mentioned here. Yeah, so and the question then is, of course, how good is our projection? And this can be revealed very well with a so-called Shepard diagram. The Shepard diagram contrasts two things. That is the distance in the high-dimensional space for the points, yeah? And this is the distance in the projected space, which is lower dimensional. And that is a local regression line here, the red one. If our projection would be ideal, then all of these points here would be exactly on the red line. We do not make any error with this projection, this would mean. Yeah? We see this here for the example that we have reduced our data to two dimension. That's meant here with k equals 2. And the stress value that tells us how good is our projection is 0.19. If it would be 0, that would be optimal. If it would be larger than 0.5, then it is a terrible projection. Yeah, so 0.19 is, yeah, an acceptable projection quality, not a good one. Yeah, so if we reduce the data not to two dimensions, but to three or four or five dimensions, then we can preserve the data better. Yeah, so we may expect that the stress value will be lower if k increases. Yeah, in this example, we see with three dimensions, the stress value is reduced to 0.13. And with four dimensions, it's slightly between 0.1. Yeah? You also see this visually here, that the points are closer to the red lines compared to this projection. So I should be more precise what these dots here are. This is always one pairwise distance between a pair of points. Yeah, that is what you see here. How this is typically interpreted. If the stress value is higher than 0.2, the projection is poor. Yeah, so that would be not good. And here we are quite close to this point where it is considered as poor. Between 0.1 and 0.2, it's fair, it's acceptable. That is what we have here. If it is below 0.1, and here it's at least slightly below 0.1, so that's the area that is considered as good. And if it would be below 0.05, that would be excellent. Yeah, I made these images here from a video tutorial that's a link to a YouTube video tutorial from Matthew Klapphahn. Yeah, so the stress value indicates roughly the global quality of the reduction that we have. Yeah, only the global quality. So that means certain features may be preserved quite well and others not so well. Yeah, a global quality is always a kind of an average number. Yeah, and you know that the individual and local measurements could deviate quite strongly from a global average. Yeah, so sometimes an analyst's question may be better answered with a projection that has a slightly higher stress value, but preserves some features better. Yeah, I just want to make you aware that to look only at this stress value is not ideal. That remains you to similar situations, for example, when we assess the quality of a clustering with a silhouette coefficient or so. To look at one global quality measure is only a starting point for assessing the quality of something. So we have seen actually multidimensional scaling results several times, and in particular when we discussed the results of subspace clustering. There were examples from Andrada Tattoo's work, but also the work in our group from Shiva Alemzadeh. Typically, multidimensional scaling is used to reveal the results of subspace clustering. Yeah? We may generate four or five dimensional subspaces, and we want to show how similar subspaces are, and we have a distance metric that takes into account how strongly two subspaces overlap in terms of the data sets that belong to these subspace clusters, as well as with respect to the dimensions. So that forms our distance metric, and we take this into account when computing a projection with multidimensional scaling. Yeah, and for text analytics, as I briefly mentioned, multidimensional scaling is also used quite frequently. Let me make a few remarks with respect to the performance, the computational effort that we have here. We have to compute all distances between all pairs of points. That would give us a complexity of n squared, but our overall complexity is larger since we have many, many iterations. And typically the number of iterations also depends on the number of data. So the overall complexity is proportional to n to the third potence. Yeah? And that is not feasible for large data when we have, for example, 10,000 or even more points. Later, an algorithm was introduced by Chalmers that has a complexity of n squared. So that's much better, of course, but even for really large data, too complex. And in 2002, Morrison came up with a stochastic algorithm. So now we have some random component incorporated that produces results that are quite similar to Chalmers algorithms, not exactly the same, but quite similar. And this algorithm is even faster. Basically, that has a linear complexity. Yeah? And let me briefly comment on how this works. Instead of computing the distance between all pairs of points, yeah, we only compute distances between a small sets of points in order to assess the quality of the current projection, compute a stress value, and decide whether or not we should try to optimize this even further. So, and of course, all the magic lies in selecting these small sets of points. They should be chosen in such a way that they are, to a certain extent, representative for the distances that we have in the whole data set. Yeah? And we do the following for this. We choose the top n nearest neighbors for every point. Yeah? For the point pi, we search for, let's say, the 10 nearest neighbors, and we are interested in how far are they away from each other. And then we look how far are they away in the projection. Hopefully that is proportional to each other. But in addition to looking to the n nearest neighbors, we also select a random sample. That's the stochastic component of the algorithm. A random sample of further points. Yeah. So we want to ensure that also other pairwise distances are preserved. But we do this with a sample that is much smaller than the overall data set. Yeah? And that reduces the computations from n times n minus 1 for all pairs of points to computations n multiplied with v max, the maximum number of nearest neighbors, and s max. Yeah? So that makes it linear. So honestly, even with this improvement, for really large data sets, it's not unusual that the computation time is in the area of a few minutes, for example. Yeah? So therefore, there are attempts that go beyond algorithmic optimization that try to come up with an interactive process that makes it easier to steer multidimensional scaling. So modern algorithms use for the layout a force-directed layout. We discussed force-directed layouts several times. Yeah, the basic idea is that you remember similar objects are pulled together. Yeah, so they are attracted by each other, and dissimilar objects push each other away. Yeah, that's meant with a force-directed layout. So magnetic forces in this sense are simulated. That's also an iterative process. It's carried out several times until the layout no longer changes considerably. Yeah. So it stops when the stress function does not decrease any further. I don't want to show the video here in the lecture. It's approximately a 5-minute video lecture that explains not multidimensional scaling but force-directed layout that is actually included in many MDS realizations. When we compare this to principal component analysis that we discussed in the last video lecture, Principal component analysis creates new axes, and the problem was that they are hard to interpret. Yeah, these are weighted combinations of the original dimensions of the data, and when we try to interpret, we would use these weightings. So to a certain extent, to a large extent, dimension A and B are involved in this new dimension, and only to a moderate extent, dimension C and all other influences are very small. Yeah. So it is hard to interpret the axis, but it could be possible. Here with multidimensional scaling, the axis have no meaning at all. Yeah? The only thing that you can infer from a multidimensional scaling is objects that are placed close to each other are similar, and those that are far away from each other are not similar. So there are some parameters in this algorithm. Some of them relate to the termination. Yeah. So we could say we want to stop whenever the stress function is below a certain value, yeah, or when the gradient is very small, which means that with further iterations we will not get much better. Yeah, a combination of both could be good. We cannot know in advance to which stress value the optimization would actually converge. So if we would say we want to stop when we reach a stress value below 0.1, maybe we never reach it. Yeah, but then we should stop also, and a good idea would be to say if the gradient is very small, we stop, no matter whether our stress value is already very good. So, and for this accelerated variant with the stochastic algorithm, we had, of course, these two parameters, Smax and Vmax, that tell us how many nearest neighbors we should take into account and how many further points that are randomly selected. Yeah, so 10 and 5 could be a good selection. Yeah, let me comment on the idea from Williams and Tamara Manzner on progressive multidimensional scaling. Progressive algorithms are frequently used in computer graphics and in visualization to show meaningful intermediate results to the user in case of lengthy computations where the user may stop the algorithm. So they need to be interruptible for this purpose when it turns out that after seeing an intermediate result, that is probably not what we want to say, what we want to see. As a simple example, if you have a low internet connection, it would be nice if you want to load an image that you see a coarse version of this image first before you see more refined versions. This is better compared to transmitting the data row-wise or column-wise, so then you have to wait for a long time until you get an idea of how this image would look like. Yeah, this very idea of having basically a hierarchy of results with very coarse results on top and more refined results in the lower parts of this hierarchy was here applied to multidimensional scaling. So the question is, of course, what is a good subset of points to start with when we apply multidimensional scaling? Yeah, that could be a random selection. It could be a selection that is somehow representative for the data. We could, for example, use a hierarchical data structure. In 3D, that could be an octree, and make sure that we use points from different portions and different regions of the data, and we compute the multidimensional scaling for them. Yeah, and if this turns out to be not what the user is interested, he may easily stop this without losing some minutes before the final result is computed. Yeah, so that is such an initial result. And that is a final result with many more points projected. So here at the end we have 50,000 points, and this took 2.5 minutes in this example. Yeah. So you may say that's 10 years old, we have better hardware, probably instead of 2.5 minutes we would have to wait maybe only half a minute. But in the same time, also in many applications, the sizes of the data sets have been increasing. And an observation from many analysts is that the size of data sets increased stronger than the computational speed increased. So performance problems have not disappeared and probably will not disappear in the near future. Yeah, so with this progressive method, users can immediately start to explore the dataset. They have a kind of overview, and then they may select local areas where they are particularly interested, and then see the final result first for these local areas. Yeah, so that is meant with steerable. The user has an influence on what happened. Yeah, and I'm convinced of the conclusion of the authors here, and state it here in a similar way as they did it in their paper. A global method that is hard to control was transformed in a local method that can be steered. Yeah, that's progressive multidimensional steering. And that's basically everything I wanted to say about multidimensional scaling, the first of our two major algorithms here. The second one is stochastic neighborhood embedding. The goal is to preserve global and local structure of the data when mapping from a high dimensional space to two or three dimensional data. Yeah? Global structure means primarily clusters, and clusters could occur at different scales, as we have discussed when we thought about hierarchical clustering. Yeah? There may be a higher level cluster that contains some lower level clusters, and local structure means primarily distances and neighbors. Yeah? So ideally, if in high dimensional space for a point P, the five nearest neighbors are A, B, C, D, and E, and we project the data, after projection of P, when we look again for the five nearest neighbor, ideally these would be the projections of A, B, C, D, and E. Yeah? That would mean we preserve the local structure. We definitely will not achieve that for all points, all nearest neighbors are the same. Yeah? But the overlap in how many nearest neighbors are preserved would be a metric that could be used in order to assess such a dimension reduction technique. The basic stochastic neighborhood embedding was introduced by Hinton and Rowise in 2002. And they convert Euclidean distances between points in high dimensional space to conditional probabilities that represent similarities. Yeah? So the similarity of xi and xj is reflected in the conditional probability that xi picks xj as its neighbor. And this probability would be highest if xj is really the closest point to xi. It would be a bit smaller if it's in the neighborhood, but not the nearest neighbor. If it is outside a certain radius, this conditional probability is in fact zero. Yeah? And the probability is computed according to a Gaussian function. And the Gaussian function is centered at the point for which we search for a neighbor. And yeah, you know the shape of the Gaussian function, this symmetric curve that goes down quite rapidly. If you are two or three standard deviations away from the center, it goes down very strongly to values of around 0.01. Yeah? So that's how this is computed. Yeah? Here is the exact computation of this conditional probability. That looks quite complex, but it reminds you to a Gaussian function. Yeah, so we have an exponential function here with a negative exponent. Here is the distance between the two points squared, and that is divided by the standard deviation squared and multiplied with 2. And this is divided by basically the same expression, but now summed up over all the points that are inside a certain region, a certain hypersphere around our point xi. Yeah? That gives us the conditional probability. So we see here a very similar formula, and this is the computation of the conditional probability in the projected space. Yeah? So basically we have now replaced here x with y, yeah? So the yi and yj are the points in the projected space, and the conditional probability of choosing I as the neighbor for QG is computed this way. Yeah? And ideally, these two distributions, the PJI and the QJI, are as close as possible, as similar as possible. So that is what the optimization process should ensure. So the question is, how do we compute the difference between such distributions? There is one technique that is really frequently used, the standard technique for this purpose, that's the Kullback-Leibler divergence. Yeah, the Kullback-Leibler divergence takes into account the distributions of the P's that we have seen on the last slide and the distributions of the Q's. It sums up over all points, I and J, so that's the double sum here, and the conditional probabilities are taken into account from high-dimensional space and low-dimensional space. It's a logarithmic function, and that all is summed up and tell us the similarity between the P and Q distributions. A few remarks on the Kullback-Leibler divergence. That is not a symmetric relation. So the Kullback-Leibler divergence between A and B is different from the Kullback-Leibler divergence of B and A. The Kullback-Leibler divergence leads to high costs, and that means the similarity is low. If points that are close in high-dimensional space, maybe even nearest neighbors in high-dimensional space, are mapped in the projection to points that are far away. Yeah? So that should not happen. If I and J are very close in the original space, they should not be projected far away from each other. On the other hand, it causes less of a problem for this kind of computation if points that are distant in high-dimensional space are mapped to close points in low-dimensional space. Yeah? So the local similarity is preserved quite well, but if something is projected close to each other, that does not necessarily mean that in the original high-dimensional space the points were also close to each other. The essential parameter that controls stochastic neighborhood embedding is the perplexity, that is basically the variance of the Gaussian function. There are different strategies how this could be chosen. It could be a global value. It could also be a good idea to start this algorithm with several values for the perplexity parameter, as we will see in a moment. It may be even a good idea that the variance is locally adapted to the density of the data. So if we have a high density of the data, which in fact means that we find a lot of neighbors in a small environment, then a lower value is more appropriate than in a sparse region. Yeah? So if the density differs strongly in our data set, it may be necessary to choose such a strategy to find a good perplexity value. Typically, and that is the good news, the results are rather stable for small changes of the perplexity parameter. Yeah? It's typically not the case that a small change alters the result completely. Yeah, some results to the optimization. So again, I want to discuss performance a little bit. Naive implementation often leads to local minima that have not a really good quality. So therefore, often Gaussian noise is added to the coordinates of the points, and the amount of Gaussian noise is reduced in every step. Yeah? Better results can be achieved if two parameters are adjusted. So first the initial amount of noise, and then how strongly this amount of noise is reduced. Yeah? So here is an example of running the stochastic neighborhood embedding algorithms to data of this digit data set. That means many handwritten digits are seen here, and they are color coded. So here you see all the threes, and here you see all the twos, and here you see all the zeros, for example. Yeah, and fortunately, that that is what you want to have. They are separated by each other, so it's not crowded and strongly overlapping here, the threes and the twos, or the zeros and the three. Here is one zero that's quite close to a two, yeah, but typically that's not too bad, yeah. So the class separation works quite well here, although the algorithm does not explicitly use this, yeah. It is not a constraint that only points that belong to the same class should be projected close to each other, yeah. So that's quite well. However, the original stochastic neighborhood embedding often had a problem that becomes quite severe, namely the so-called crowding problem. The crowding problem basically means that if we project this in 2D to a kind of scatterplot-based representation, often most of the points are projected in the middle of the projection area. Yeah, so you remember scatterplot-based representations. That actually would mean if we have a large amount of data, we have a large amount of overplotting in the central area. And it's quite typical that we have large areas where nothing is projected into. And that is somehow unfortunate. Yeah, it would be better if we could really exploit the space that we have available. And that gave rise to the improvement from Louis van der Maaten, the T-stochastic neighborhood embedding. So basically, he replaced the Gaussian function with a T function, the student T distribution, and to be more specific, it's the student T distribution with one degree of freedom. Yeah, you remember the computation of the conditional probability of choosing neighbor J for the point E in the projected image. That is now computed based to the student T distribution and not according to the Gaussian distribution. Why this is a good idea, yeah, and why he even tried to use this function instead. He reasoned that the crowding problem is due to the fact that the Gaussian function is quite narrow. That means the function goes down quite fast to values that are below 0.01. The T distribution has a wider tail and therefore should lead to a reduction of the crowding problem. That was his assumption, and indeed he could show that this is the case. Yeah. Let me briefly illustrate with this image from his paper the comparison here. The Gaussian function, that is this function here that has the lowest value if we have if we are more than two standard deviations away from the center. Yeah, when we are at three standard deviations, this is clearly below 0.01. Here are different variants of the T function with different degrees of freedom, 1, 5, 10, and 30. And the best one for his purpose is really the one with one degree of freedom, that is the blue one. Yeah. That has rather low values here, only 0.3 instead of 0.4 here. But here in the outer regions of the function, it has, for example, a value of approximately 0.03 instead of lower than 0.01 if we are three standard deviations away of the center. Yeah. Yeah, so that's the T-stochastic neighborhood embedding, and I think it's fair to say that meanwhile that is the frequently used method and no longer the original stochastic neighborhood embedding. The naive approach to implement this has a quadratic complexity. Approximative solutions are possible that have the complexity of n times log n. And the basic idea is here to replace individual distance computations by averages over a small neighborhood. And to do this efficiently, you need to create a hierarchical data structure to represent the objects, so for example, an octree. Yeah? And with an octree representation, these points here could be part of one octree node, and yeah, we compute just the average distance of this point to these nodes here instead of computing all the individual distances. Yeah, that would make this faster. And yeah, that's screenshot I captured from a talk from Louis van der Maarten. So the quality here is not quite nice, but you may recognize that this is still the digit data set. Yeah, we have these many handwritten digits representing 28 times 28 pixels, and many features are derived from these 784 pixels. That is our high dimensional space. We compute the similarity of the many individual realizations of these digits in high dimensional space and project with TSNE in two dimensions. And what we see here is that the different classes, and the class always means one specific number from 0 to 9, are separated quite well without a noticeable crowding problem. Yeah? So the space here is used quite well. Yeah? That's the T-stochastic neighborhood embedding. Yeah, let me comment a bit on this perplexity parameter that is so important. It controls the balance between two local and global aspects of the data. It is a guess about the number of close neighbors that should be taken into account. One thing that's really essential is the perplexity parameter should be smaller, and I would add it should be considerably smaller than the number of points in the data set. If you have only 100 points in the data set, your perplexity parameter should not be 100. Yeah? Typical values for the perplexity parameter are in the range of 5 to 50, and 50 is a good value if you have quite large data sets. Yeah? Getting the most from TSNE may mean analyzing multiple plots with different perplexities. That was the statement of Martin Wattenberg. He provides a tool that you can use yourself that's available online. I used it myself as well to play around with different data sets, with TSNE projection and with different perplexity parameters. Yeah. So here are some examples that are generated this way. That is an original data set. In high dimensions, we have basically two clusters. Yeah. With perplexity 2 and the algorithm runs 5,000 times, well, that does not work very well. Yeah, we should take more neighbors into account than 2. I said the typical values start from 5. With 5, yeah, well, we somehow see that here is a cluster and here is a cluster, but it is not ideal. Yeah, we get better results with 30 or 50 or maybe even 100. If you have 5,000 points or so, that could work. Yeah, so 30 and 50 here are quite well. You see there are still slight differences, but it becomes clear that here are points that belong together in the sense that they have been close to each other in the high dimensional space and here as well. And no orange point is close to a blue point, which represents the distances that they have in high dimensional space before. Some more examples, that's a random Gaussian walk. And yeah, the data is shown after projection in 2D with perplexity parameters 10, 30, or 50. Yeah, and 30 and 50 better represent this random character of the walk. The right data set is somehow different. We have 100 points here as well, but here also, representing two clusters. Blue cluster and an orange cluster, and both of them have 50 points. The blue cluster is quite dense and compact, and the orange cluster is sparse. Yeah? And this difference in the density cannot be represented well with a perplexity parameter of 10, better with perplexity parameter of 30, and really good with the perplexity parameter of 50. Yeah? You see here, in the moment occluded by my face, a link where you can explore this yourself. Yeah, so let me discuss this a little bit. T-stochastic neighborhood embedding performs a density equalization, and as a consequence of this, dense clusters may be expanded and sparse clusters may be contracted. Yeah? The relative sizes of the clusters therefore cannot be assessed very well with a TSNE projection. Noisy data do not always look noisy. Yeah? So the resulting shapes may be misleading. And also the relative distances between clusters cannot be assessed. We have seen examples with two clusters. Imagine for a moment that we have three clusters. And imagine that they are nicely separated. Here is a cluster, and here, and here. But what you cannot infer from such a projection is the distances between these clusters. Yeah? If you see that cluster A is closer to cluster B than to cluster C, that does not mean that in the high-dimensional space that was also the case. Yeah? That is what the projection cannot ensure. Yeah, here are some more examples, and indeed here we have three clusters, two that are close to each other, one that is further away, perplexity 2 is too small, 5 is better, 30, 50, that converges somehow, at least in the sense that the clusters are represented well. You see that they are placed in different parts of the our layout, of our projection area, so the position of a cluster does not mean anything. Yeah? And you also see that the clusters basically form a triangle where all the edges have the same length. So the differences in the distance between blue and orange and blue and green, for example, are not represented well, as I briefly commented before. Yeah, van der Maarten himself made several extensions to his T-SNE method. So for example, he extends single maps to multiple maps to convey more features of the data. So with this, he argues that we can support multiple perspectives on the same data. Similarity is modeled as a weighted sum over the similarity in these individual maps. So in this example here, he created 40 document maps. Yeah, you see this here, that is the first document map. That is one of the later document maps. So here the user can select which of the maps he wants to see. This should be a manageable number. 40 maybe is already quite a lot. 400 definitely would be too much. Yeah. So that's the idea of multiple maps. There are also other nonlinear dimension reduction techniques, and at visual analytics conferences that is discussed frequently. I would argue that multidimensional scaling and t-stochastic neighborhood embedding still are the dominating ones, but there are others like isomap and spectral embedding. Sometimes new methods have been developed with the goal of being faster, of being more efficient. Yeah. So here you see computational timings where TSNE and MDS are indeed slower than spectral embedding and isomaps. So, and I also want to present one idea that fits well to visual analytics because the user has more influence, he's in the loop. He may guide the projection process. The paper that I introduce here has exactly the title that I used here for my headline, Crafted Projections, yeah, from Michael Gleicher. And maybe the idea can really be explained very well with the data that was used in this paper. The paper used the city livable data as major use case to demonstrate this method. That means for many large cities like Cairo and Mumbai and New York, so spread over the world, a lot of information is available with respect to the quality of healthcare, the crime rate in different categories, leisure facilities, the quality of transportation, and so on. And what the user can do here is to select one city and start a projection that should primarily preserve how close are all the other cities to the selected ones. Yeah. So maybe I select my hometown and I want to see which other cities are similar to my hometown in terms of these data. Yeah. As an alternative, the user may also select two cities, and with two cities you span a two-dimensional space. Let's say the user selects Paris and New York, and then we may assess whether a city is more similar to Paris or to New York, or maybe it is dissimilar to both of them. Yeah. One may even ask whether there is something like Americanness. Yeah. It could be that all American cities like Houston and Chicago and Los Angeles are quite close to New York, whereas others are further away. That would mean there is something like Americanness in the city. Or is there something like Parisness in the data? Yeah? Let's look at some results. Yeah? Here is a projection. The user indeed selected Paris and New York. And some cities are in the middle between Paris and New York, or quite close to one of them. London is quite close to New York. Auckland, Melbourne, rather close to Paris. Also Berlin, Boston, and Chicago. Yeah? Whereas some others, like Cairo or Mumbai, are further away. Again, we have said that typically the axis does not represent something in multidimensional scaling, for example. But here we have selected these two cities, and therefore we may say that is the Parisness scale, where Paris is on the extreme, and here is the New Yorkness scale. If we look at the individual data, you remember they relate to crimes and transportation and healthcare and so on, then we could have a parallel coordinate view. So that shows us for our selected city, for example, New York, and for the closest cities, what are the specific values in the individual dimensions. Yeah? So, and indeed, he used this to explore something like Americanness in the city. Yeah? Here, indeed, the American cities are emphasized. And this one here, it's not New York, it's San Jose. That is the least American city. So that differs most from any other American city in terms of these parameters. Yeah, that's a kind of a crafted projection. So, and then let me at least start this topic of assessing projection quality. It's clear so far, projection involves an error, an approximation error. We may analyze this error objectively. That means we measure something quantitatively. We have an error metric. But on the other hand, it's also important to understand how a user, an analyst, assesses the quality. Yeah? That must not, that not necessarily coincides with an error metric that is the quantitative measure. Yeah? So ideally, we have both quantitative and qualitative information. I mentioned already a single error metric is not sufficient to carefully assess the projection quality. So therefore, also the visualization of a single error metric is also not sufficient. Ideally, we can compare different projections and in order to find out which one is better. There was one paper that really asked a number of analysts what they find important with respect to projections. So they want to understand how the error is spread over the whole area, the projection view. It's certainly not the same error everywhere, so the distribution is essential. Where are points located that are close in the projected space, but were originally far away in high-dimensional space? That may happen, but analysts would be interested to see in which regions this occurs primarily. Where are points located that are close in high-dimensional space, but far in two-dimensional space? Yeah? With stochastic neighborhood embedding, that should not occur. Yeah? Also with the other techniques, that is an exception, but it may occur for a few points. And moreover, they are interested in the influence of parameter choices. Yeah, let me first comment on measures, error metrics that could be used. Dimension reduction always involves the minimization of an objective function as part of an optimization process. So therefore, this minimal value may serve as a quality measure. That is what we have discussed already with the stress value in multidimensional scaling. That is one idea for an error metric. Another one is the overlap of the car nearest neighbors in low-dimensional space and high-dimensional space. I briefly commented on this idea before. Yeah? The quality is how many nearest neighbors to take into account. Something between 5 and 10 could be a good idea. Yeah? And we do this for all points. And then the measure that we can derive is the quality of point neighborhood preservation. In general, it should be quite high with stochastic neighborhood embedding because that is what this method tries to preserve. We can also ask not only whether the k nearest neighbors are again the k nearest neighbors, but also whether the ranking is more or less the same. So is the closest neighbor again the closest neighbor and the second closest neighbor again the second closest neighbor? That would be the local strict order preservation. So probably this number would be lower. Yeah, I would expect that it's not often feasible to project the data in such a way that not only the closest neighbors are the same, but really the precise ranking is the same. And we also may ask for the correlation of pairwise distances if we compute them in low-dimensional space and high-dimensional space and want to see how well this correlates. Yeah, these are typical quality measures, quantitative values that provide a kind of global quantitative assessment of the projection quality. Quality assessment can also be supported with visualization, and that's of course what we are interested in visual analytics. So we want to provide visual cues about the reliability of the projection, the local reliability directly in the embedding, that means in the projection area, to support a reasoning process. So we can display the distortion, for example, with a color scale on a per point basis or on a per region basis. So for example, some authors use Voronoi cells computed around the individual points and color code them according to the error that was made for the projection of this point. From a visual analytics point of view, it would be also desirable that the user can interactively explore such visualizations, yeah? That he can get an estimate of the local error on demand, or that he can ask for the error for a cluster or a certain region, yeah, with probing the visualization. That was introduced by Stahnke and colleagues from Potsdam. Yeah, here we see examples. The Swiss role data set is shown. The quality of the TSNE projection with perplexity parameter 50 is shown for different neighborhood sizes. Yeah, the lower right image, that is this one here, has really a bad quality. Yeah, that's the worst one. This one here is better. And the local distribution is shown here. When something is white, that means the quality is really good. Yellow is acceptable. But when we are in the red or even brown areas, we really have a low quality. And that would mean that we have points here that are projected far away from other points that originally were close to each other. Yeah, so that's a tiering phenomenon. We no longer have one continuous element, one manifold that we originally have. The tiers here become quite obvious, and that is indicated with the color. So I can rely more on the projection that I see here compared to these orange, red, or brown points. There are two types of errors. Yeah? The question is not only what is the amount of error, but also what category of errors we have. A tier is a point that is very close. That means that we have points very close to each other in the original high-dimensional space that are now mapped far away from each other. That would mean a tier. Yeah, I commented this on the Swiss role data sets, where we had the data lying on one manifold, and now we have separate clusters. So that means several tiers must have occurred. The opposite is a so-called false neighborhood, and that means points are very close in the projection, although originally they were far away from each other. And if this happens often, the impression of a cluster may occur, although in high-dimensional space there was no cluster. So it would be nice if we could discriminate which type of error occurred and to what extent, of course, as well. Yeah. So ideally, the type and extent of error should be shown. Yeah. When clusters of data points appear, their existence in the original space is taken for granted without measuring how much their course is due to the distortions in the projection. Yeah, that is the observation. Yeah, and just to show this, here we have original data, here we have a projection of the data, and here we have this point again, and a tear occurs in the surrounding of this point. No longer these points are shown in a way that represents their original distances quite well. In this region, everything is fine. Rows and columns are preserved quite well, here as well, but somehow they moved away from each other. And the false neighborhood situation is what we have here. We have one point here, and the distance to the neighbors is the same like in other areas of the original data, but in the projection, for whatever reason, many points are shown here in a small neighborhood, leading to the impression of a cluster, and that is an instance of a false neighborhood. Yeah, with this I would close this video lecture. The second part will continue here with the assessment of projection quality and with a guided process for dimension reduction. To briefly summarize, we have learned a bit about multidimensional scaling and about t-stochastic neighborhood embedding, one deterministic algorithm and one that is stochastic. We have seen examples for them with smaller data, artificial data, but also with larger data. We discussed quality criteria and how these could be conveyed to the user. And we also discussed how the user can control this process, steer this process, in particular how he can avoid that he has to wait for minutes until a first good result is computed. Yeah. With this, I want to thank